mention this really quick, you guys. I totally forgot to show off my Ghostbusters collection of films on 4K. I am all about physical media. You know this. I care so much about this. There may be some things I'll get digitally, but for the most part, I care so much about physical stuff. I do these to collect movies that I really appreciate, or at the very least, I enjoy. And there are some that aren't good, which is what this review will probably be about. They can't all be winners, and unfortunately, that's not the case here.
You're short, your belly button sticks out too far, and you're a terrible burden on your poor mother.
Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis, and Ernie Hudson in an Ivan Reitman film. Ghostbusters 2.
We're the best, we're the beautiful, we're the only Ghostbusters. We're back! Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters 2. Before I start any further, I gotta do the peace sign. The Ghostbusters 2 was once again directed by Ivan Reitman and written once again by Harold Ramis and Dan Aykroyd. All of the original cast returns, including Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis, Ernie Hudson, and Annie Potts. According to IMDb's plot synopsis, the discovery of a massive river of ectoplasm and a resurgence of spectral activity allows the staff of the Ghostbusters to revive the business. Just like the first film, I watched Ghostbusters 2. When I was young, and I was never a huge fan of the second movie. I always thought that the second film was always kind of bizarre to me, because it was just like coming off of the first movie, and then you watch this, and you're like, this feels off for some reason. Like, you compare the two, and you're like, there are some things here that I see are similar in one area, and there are some where I'm like, this is just weird, man. This is just like going all over the place. And having rewatched the film, I still feel the same way. In fact, as much as I love physical media, and I told you this, you guys, sometimes you just collect things in a series that even you know a franchise, there are sometimes always bad ones. I think the ones I have watched, this is the worst film in the franchise. I know I think I might be exaggerating when I say this, but I truly believe that Ghostbusters 2 might be the worst in the franchise. Before dogpiling it, here are some of the only positives that I can really give about this movie. The performances. They're all entertaining. All four members of the Ghostbusters, Murray, Aykroyd, Ramis, and Hudson, are all great together. Murray once again plays Venkman as the ladies' man and sarcastic member of the team, as always. Aykroyd is still sharp and witty as Stance, while Ramis is bizarre and genius as Spangler. Hudson, who was in the first film, and I didn't mention him in my review of the original film, and that's just because he doesn't have a lot of screen time, and this is actually one of the things that I'll address probably later when we get to Frozen Empire, but I just didn't address him because he just wasn't in it much, although I do enjoy his performance in the original. He's more present as Winston Zeddemore. As the fourth member of the Ghostbusters, this is a recap from the first film, he's more grounded and level-headed compared to the other guys, because the other guys, one's a schlub, the other one is just a conspiracy theorist, the other one is just bizarre. So he's the only one that's like a normal human being who is set amongst two weirdos and one loser. I mean, you could say that they're all losers, but really, two of them are weirdos, the other one is just a loser. In this film, he still brings the same energy in here, although I will say they do subject them at times to really stupid things, which is unfortunate. One scene in particular in a subway system with both Aykroyd and Ramis, which is kind of sad. Together, they're amazing when bouncing off of each other. I can really say that for sure, that for both of these movies, every one of the cast seems to have good rapport with each other, and they knew when to bounce off of each other when they needed to. And that was the biggest highlight I could say about this movie, is that rapport that you saw in the first movie, it's still here. Sigourney Weaver is stubborn and delightful as Dan Barrett. Once again, both Murray and Weaver still have great chemistry with each other. They know how to play off of each other and keep their relationships still entertaining. First and foremost, Sigourney Weaver, talented actress, still brings an entertainment factor to Dana, and having her play off of Murray again, you could tell that they have that chemistry with each other, that they know how to just get under each other's skins, or sometimes just flirt with each other at times. Really, Bigman getting under Barrett's skin, but she just always gets enamored with him. Always. Rick Moranis is, again, the lovable goofball of Lewis Tully. We see Lewis play a more interactive role with the Ghostbusters, which is nice to see. Because, you know, in the first movie, he, you know, interacted the most with Dana. You never really saw him interact with the Ghostbusters until, like, near the end. So it was just nice to see that Rick Moranis could still return, although I do find it weird that he is their lawyer. And I would think he would be more of a financial advisor to them, but I guess he's a lawyer too. Andy Potts-Dessouy is Jane Milnitz, the Ghostbusters secretary. Like with Hudson, she wasn't in it that much in the original film, so to see her be brought back was fun to watch. And I also enjoyed her in the first movie, especially that one scene where someone's answering a phone and she just picks it up and she's like, "Ghostbusters, what do you want?" Great. But she's always a delight to watch in that first movie, although I wish she was given more, but it wasn't like a problem I have with it. It was just time-wise. So it was just nice that she was brought back. Direction is solid. Ivan Reitman still brings his all and shows his passion for this series. He still managed to keep the fun nature of the Ghostbusters throughout. He used to really care so much about this franchise and what it meant to him, of what this represented with regards to, I guess, New Yorkers. And, I mean, there's a reason why. I mean, he really shows the Ghostbusters in a way that shows the strength of just average, normal people. And whether it be just bizarre weirdos, a schlub, or just a down-to-earth type of guy, it just shows the determination factor that normal human beings can do to be in a position of wanting to save people. So it was nice to see that Ivan Reitman still cares so much about having the relatability factor with the Ghostbusters. The pacing and runtime is on point. Just like the first film, the pacing is endless with each scene. With a runtime of 1 hour and 48 minutes, it feels right. And I'm glad that they still kind of kept it within that same ballpark, although it's getting a little bit close to 2 hours. I'm still kind of glad that it was still within the realm of what the first movie was with regards to its runtime, because if it had gone any further, I still think it would have outstayed its welcome. So, thankfully, it kept that same momentum. That said, this movie feels like a repeated and dumb version of the original. And I have to emphasize dumb and repetitive to this film. So, here are some of the negatives. The story is messy. It feels like a repeat of the first film, except they're coming back from being shut down, which is just such a bizarre choice to have the Ghostbusters already be shut down since they helped save the world in the first movie. They explained it in the beginning, like, why they got shut down. I don't know, it's just a strange choice for a sequel where you saw how they were created. You saw them at their highest, and you saw them save the world. So you would think that New York would appreciate the gratitude that the Ghostbusters had to it. No, because apparently a lot of places in New York really just did not like the fact that, New York State rather, did not like the fact that these Ghostbusters were meddling around, and so they shut them down. Which is really weird to me, because after saving the world and all, you would think that, you know, there would be some gratitude for helping them. No, there wasn't. And the movie addresses that it was that, you know, stopping Gozer was what shut them down. Not like in terms of like they collected all the ghosts or anything like that. No, they just got shut down because they saved the world. Okay. I don't know why, but alright. The effects haven't aged well. Compared to the first, the ghosts look more cartoonish than the first. Especially Slimer. Slimer, I think, has got to be the worst looking, I think, ghost in this movie, because it just looks so much like a cartoon. The original had that cartoonish nature, but it wasn't, like, expressive in, like, the eyes with regards to, like, you know, they're big and they're very, you know, he's very much more expressive. Like, I'm liking the fact that in the original, it was a ghost, but could be expressive through his voice and through the motion of the puppet. And so for having this be a little bit more cartoonish looking with some of the ghosts in this movie, it just felt really bizarre, because that first movie knew when to balance comedy and horror. This one felt like it was going more for the comedy aspect. And the green screen usage in this has not aged the best. And it makes the film look dated. This really does look like a dated film. The first movie you could still watch, and there are dated parts, but it's okay. It still holds up very well. Maybe some minor things, but it holds up fantastically after 4 years. This movie? No, unfortunately not. This movie has not aged well in any sort of way. The writing is not good. I feel like Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis seem to have leaned too much into the comedy, like I said, than having the balanced tone. Because again, Ghostbusters knew when to have comedy and when to have horror, and have those two go back and forth with each other. It just starts to feel more lighthearted than it was. Because the first movie had maybe some lighthearted moments, but for the most part, it was still fun enough to where everybody can enjoy it. And while I understand that you can have things made for kids, like, trust me, what I have in my background truly shows that you could still have things that can be appealing to kids. I just think that by doing this, it just kind of feels like a whiplash in a way, where you just weren't expecting it. And it just kind of leans a little bit too goofy with the comedy. It just kind of felt almost sillier. But again, that's just me. Maybe some people like that. And that's okay. I just, for myself, it just feels so off coming off of what the first movie was like. The villain is forgettable. With Gozer, I at least remember them. But this villain, Viggo the Carpathian, I had to look them up. Like, I had to look up the villain's name. Because I could not remember who the villain was. Because they're just not that threatening. I mean, I could say the same thing about Gozer, but at least Gozer summoned something that is intimidating. This is just, it's just rivers of slime, and just the same as the original. Ghosts are just unleashed upon New York when it's in chaos. I do think the concept is cool, like this painting that influences people. It's just not executed well enough, especially with that script. It's just not well thought out. The mayor's assistant subplot just feels tacked on. His only purpose in the film is to be an obstacle later on in the movie. Like, when the Ghostbusters, and I guess you could say this is spoilers, so, but the movie's been out for decades at this point. The Ghostbusters get sent to, like, a mental institute by the mayor's assistant for being insane, crazy people. I can't help but feel like it feels like a retry of Walter Peck, but just not as funny, because at least William Afton, who played Walter Peck in the original, was at least funny enough to, like, poke fun at, and just came off as what we usually expect sometimes government officials to be. This one just felt like a lighter, watered-down version of that. Just not as funny as Walter Peck. But also, too, he just tries so hard to be like him. The music's just not memorable. Composer Randy Edelman can't recapture Elmer Bernstein's score or add to the series as a whole. There's just not a catchy tune that just sticks out in my mind. That there's just nothing that is there with regards to a piece of music in this movie that is recognizable. At least with the first movie, I could recognize some really good iconic pieces of music. Here I can't, because most of it kind of feels like I said, it feels dated in a way with regards to its music. But at least Ray Parker Jr.'s song returns, and it's still fun to listen to. That's at least the best part, is that they still use this song because they know that it is so synonymous with this franchise and what it represents. So of course it would return, but I'm just glad that it was used only twice in the film, just like how I believe in the original. I think in the original it was three times. This one was only twice, so I'm at least glad that they didn't milk the song, so that's at least good. The cinematography seems shoddy. If you compare both the first and second film, Ghostbusters 2 just doesn't feel natural or grounded. Like, the way the camera movement feels in this movie doesn't feel natural with regards to how characters move around. It all feels static. It all feels like it is like just standard shots, rather than actually feeling like it's flowing whenever characters are walking around, or a little bit wider with conversations. Everything also kind of feels like it's a little bit more up close with some of the characters, which was kind of weird. Cinematographer Mike Chapman, who's worked with Scorsese on a lot of his films, and somewhat with Ivan Reitman, but mostly with Martin Scorsese, and he makes some really amazing looking films, you know, if you look at Martin Scorsese's work. It's just not his best. This is by far not a great looking movie. Again, it feels like a standard looking 80s film than it would stand out. This is a huge downgrade. To live up to the first film, this didn't at all. I wasn't expecting it to, you know, before rewatching it, I wasn't expecting it to be grand as I remember, but I was expecting, like, at least an enjoyable time. I couldn't find that here, you guys. For me personally, I just couldn't. This is truly a case of sequelitis, and yes, that is a word, whenever it just feels like it was a movie that was made to just make a sequel to the original. And you can say that a lot about other movies, but I just feel like in this case, it truly feels like that. So yeah, I'm gonna give Ghostbusters 2 a 3 out of 10. It's just not a great movie. I honestly think it's terrible, and it's weird because, yeah, I have the 4K, but, you know, again, when you're in a series that you do enjoy, and there are some enjoyments, it's just always the one that's going to stand out the most to me, and it's no surprise that after this movie, there wasn't another Ghostbusters movie for many years until a certain movie came along in 2016, but, yeah, so... Yes, I will now have my review for Ghostbusters Afterlife, and then soon Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. So yeah, look forward to those reviews and other movie TV show reviews coming soon.